Hello, everyone. This time around, I want to talk about self-driving cars. Now, I can't remember if I've talked about this before, but it's an ongoing topic, so it's worth rehashing if I have. They're getting more and more traction on the roads lately. There's actual trials going on actual real roads, and it's looking like they're going to be a real thing in some capacity in the relatively near future, in a decade or so probably, or possibly a little longer, but very likely it's going to happen before the middle of the century. And that is a good reason to talk about it. Now, there are some issues that these self-driving cars have to deal with. First of all, they have to be able to deal with road conditions. If they can't do that, then they cannot competently operate a motor vehicle. That is just a fact. And that's the problem the manufacturers are trying to solve right now, getting the cars to actually handle road conditions that as they exist. Now, whether I think they're going down the right direction, technologically speaking, on how they equip the vehicles and so on, that's another discussion. It's a big one all on its own. A short answer, I think they're going down the wrong road. They're trying to solve the problems the wrong way, but eventually they'll figure it out and come up with either make the direction they're going work or realize that it's not working and come up with a better solution. But anyway, what does a driver need to be able to do to operate a vehicle? Well, you have to be able to steer it in the direction that you have chosen to steer it. You have to be able to operate the accelerator and the brakes, so that the throttle and the brakes. So that means that you have to be able to give it gas and apply the brakes. You have to be able to operate the indicators, the signal lights. And you have to be able to follow the road. Those parts are obvious. And those parts are the easy part, in fact. What else do you have to do as a driver? Well, you have to be able to read and understand road signs, particularly regulatory signs like lane markers and that sort of thing. You have to be able to understand what's a turn lane and what isn't. You have to understand how to deal with a stop sign. You have to understand how to deal with traffic lights. You have to understand what construction signs mean. You have to understand what construction zones are and how to deal with those. And you have to have some understanding of the regulations that apply to motor vehicles. You also have to be able to identify obstacles and deal with them. That might mean stopping if there's something in front of you. It might mean swerve and avoid. But you have to be able to deal with these situations. And you also have to be able to deal with situations where the road markings are unclear or missing. You have to be able to deal with all manner of these random situations that show up quite regularly. And you might be thinking that road markings could be, and that sort of thing, could be made perfect and, you know, with properly constructed roads and so on. But there's always something that can obscure road markings. Even if it's just snow in a cold climate. I can tell you from experience that driving on a snowy or icy road, leaving aside any traction issues that you might have due to the cold or the snow and ice, leaving that aside, driving on a snow-covered or ice-covered road is a completely different ballgame than driving on bare pavement with clear markings. The thing to remember is that under most highway codes that I'm familiar with, all highway codes I'm actually familiar with, to be honest, If the road markings are unclear, then they cannot be deemed to exist. So if you can't see any lines on the road, there are no lines on the road. Even if they're there under a snowpack, there are no lines on that road, and you have to treat it as such. And that, and there are regulations on how to do that. Now, and there are conventions that people will tend to use as well, like keeping right on two-way traffic in North America, for instance. And that's just conventions that are there to prevent accidents, and they work fairly well. And a lot of this stuff you can teach to the self-driving car mechanism, the brain in the car. And that does, that can work quite well. Now, you can teach the brain how to deal with the rules of the road and most road conditions in a situation where everybody else is behaving properly with no particular problems. It's not a particularly difficult problem once you solve the sensory problem of identifying lanes and that sort of thing. It's dealing with the exceptional circumstances, identifying that dog or that child running into the street from the side, or that animal coming across the highway ahead of you, or that car that pulled out of a driveway without looking, things like that. And that sort of thing is where these self-driving cars tend to fail these days. There was that news story about the Tesla autopilot that drove into a big truck at speed. That there was clearly an issue with the autopilot thing there, and of course it was being used improperly by the car, by the driver at the same time. So there was probably shared blame there, but the driver was apparently watching a movie instead of supervising his semi-autonomous car, and that clearly violates the rules of the road, not paying attention to what your car is doing. Okay, so basically, my point is that the ordinary conditions that are likely to show up, or that will normally show up on roads, are relatively easy to deal with. Lane driving, changing lanes, that sort of thing. Handling turns, stop signs, that sort of thing. They're all relatively easy to deal with, and those problems have been largely solved. And, of course, giving the car brain some means to control the vehicle is obviously solved. We've had remote control systems for automobiles for decades, and that's an easily solved problem. So what does the self-driving car do in an exceptional circumstance? Well, this is where a lot of the debate has been showing up lately. And it's a little bit of a straw man debate when you really get down to it. Because people are getting hung up on essentially the trolley problem, which is an ethical dilemma. It is not a question that can or should be solved by a machine. The self-driving car must obey the rules of the road. That is obviously true. If it does not obey the rules of the road, then it is not a competent driver and should not be allowed on the road. That is absolutely correct, right? I don't think anybody will dispute that. Now, what do the rules of the road say when you get into a situation that's essentially the trolley problem? Well, first of all, what is the trolley problem? Well, I'm going to paraphrase it here, because there's a whole class of them, but it can be presented as any situation where you have to make a choice between two bad choices, and where there is some choice that is, by some measure, better. So say your choice is kill the occupants of the car or crash into a busload of school children. Well, most people would say you should kill the occupants of the car, except when they wouldn't say that. It's a totally artificial scenario, and I don't think that expecting a self-driving car to make a moral or ethical judgment in that situation is fair, because one, it's not required by the rules of the road, and two, no human being in that situation is going to make a proper ethical choice for whatever value is chosen to be the ethical choice. If you're coming along and you're about to crash and you can swerve and hit a wall and kill yourself, or don't swerve and hit a bus, what are you going to do? You're going to freeze and do nothing and therefore hit the bus. That's what you're going to do. That's almost certainly what I would end up doing. Is by the time I've identified the situation and realized that I should probably hit the wall to save the kids, assuming self-preservation allows me to make that choice, I've already hit the damn bus. By the time I can make a conscious choice in that situation, the situation is over. And if I have plenty of time to make the conscious choice, I will probably have already slammed on the brakes, and I will have had enough time to stop or slow down substantially enough that I do much less harm. So it actually is not really the choice between killing the children and killing yourself. It's a choice between getting into the situation in the first place and not getting into it, which means you need to watch far enough ahead for what's going on down the road. And if you do that, in almost all cases, that busload of children will be apparent long before you're in that final situation where you have to choose kill the kids or die. You're going to have plenty of time to slow down substantially. You'll have time to slam on the brake. You'll have time to swerve slightly. Where there isn't a wall, maybe, you'll have plenty of time to do something else. And if you combine that with driving in a manner where you're not overdriving your reaction time and your stopping distance, which a self-driving car can more easily do than a human, then you can't possibly get in a case where there's suddenly a busload of kids there that you're going to hit, or you have to hit a wall. That's the key right there, is the self-driving car can be instructed not to drive in a manner which is unsafe, which is not allowed by law. You're not allowed to travel too fast for conditions. You're not allowed to travel so fast that you can't react to what you see in front of you. You're not allowed to drive so fast that you can't stop before you hit the thing that's coming in front of you. There are some extenuating circumstances, which we've generally accepted as acceptable risks, such as driving along a highway at highway speed and having wildlife jump out in front of you. You're technically driving too fast if the wildlife can jump out in front of you and you still hit it. To be completely legally correct, you are supposed to be able to stop for anything that jumps out in front of you. But of course, you've got to be able to see it coming before you can do that. And there's a lot of cases where you've got 3 foot high grass right up to the shoulder of the road and you can't see anything in it. Now, here's where the self-driving car has advantages. It can have non-visual sensors. In fact, most of them do. That means they can detect things that humans can't see. That means they can see things beyond the reach of headlights, with things like LiDAR and radar and things like that. They can see things. And obviously you can interfere with that stuff, but you can interfere with visual sensors as well by shining a light on them, right? That happens to humans when someone puts their high beams on all the time. As a matter of fact, oncoming headlights make it impossible to see anything. So that's, you know, it's a fact. You can interfere with any kind of sensor package. But you could give the car sensors that it can see in every direction. You can eliminate blind spots. That means you can give that self-driving car a lot more possible options for collision avoidance. And then it can work through those possible options a lot more quickly than a human can. And if there is one where it thinks it can avoid the collision, it can take action immediately. Its reaction time is a lot faster than a human's. So if it looks like there's a tiny piece of road it can go through and not hit anything, it can take that option. Or it can come to the conclusion that it doesn't have a safe path and take the path that's going to give the maximum deceleration. If those two are the only reasonable options in a exceptional accident situation like that. A note that there is no moral choice, no ethical choice there. You either avoid hitting anything, or you stop, or try to stop. That's your only options. That's your only reasonable options. No complicated decision making is reasonable in an emergency situation. It's not going to happen. So, what I'm saying is, if the self-driving car is driving according to the rules of the road and is not overdriving its sensors, it's likely going to see that obstruction ahead of it before it gets to the point where it has to choose whether to hit it or not. It can slow down well in advance. It can even stop if it doesn't understand what it's seeing. It, you know, pull off the road and stop. The same way a human being should behave if they're thoroughly confused while driving. Pull off the road and stop. There are rules for emergency stopping. You teach the self-driving car how to deal with an emergency stop. It's got to be able to deal with that anyway in the event it detects equipment failure, right? Or any number of situations where it might have to stop. Like, for instance, the weather conditions make it impossible to control the car or something like that. You know, it gets on, it detects an icy road surface and it's not got any, doesn't have proper control or something like that. Now, identifying these situations is more difficult, and it's going to get better over time. But eventually, you're going to end up with a situation where the self-driving car is going to have a model of what's around it and what's moving where. It's going to have a vector model. It's got, okay, it's here and it's going this way, and there's this thing over to the side that's coming this way, and there's something up there that's moving sideways and it's going to intersect, and it can calculate those vectors. And it doesn't even have to calculate them extremely precisely. And this is one of the cases where a lot of the programming for this stuff goes wrong. It tries to calculate precision when it doesn't need it. It just needs to estimate it accurately enough that it can make a fairly reasonable choice now. And then as it becomes easier to estimate, it can refine the choice. That's how we do it. We don't make an accurate decision on exactly how much brake we have to put to avoid intersecting with that car that's coming on the side road. We will make a guess, and then as we get closer to that situation, we'll refine the guess. Oh, we're slowing down more than we need to. We can adjust that. You know, that sort of thing. The so-called fuzzy logic. That's what we do. We don't do accurate differential equation solving. So I think the control system makers have actually got with that program. I think they realize that, or we wouldn't have these things behaving as well as they do. But when you really get down to it, once the car brain can have a model of what's moving where around it, it can use that to identify what's likely going to cause problems, and it can actually avoid situations much more easily than a human can, because it can keep track of everything. It can keep track of everything that's behind, everything that's ahead, and it can even, obviously you're going to have to prune that somehow, but it's going to be limited by the range of the sensors anyway. And how far you have to keep track of everything, it depends on how fast you're going. And that's what it comes down to. And eventually, that's probably where we're going to end up. And we're going to have cars that don't get into these moral situations, except when there's an artificial cause. Like, say, that busload of children that you're going to hit dropped out of the sky. Well, if that's the case, you don't have a hope of detecting that, because you're not looking up for things falling out of the sky in front of you. Maybe you should be, but you're not, because it's not something that's likely going to happen, right? You're not expecting a bus to fall out of the sky. Hailstones, maybe, but not a bus, right? So a busload of children falling out of the sky, it doesn't matter whether you hit it or not. If you can't avoid it, it's going to kill the children when it hits the ground anyway, so it doesn't matter. And this is the thing that we need to understand when we're working on regulations for self-driving cars. We cannot expect them to be making ethical or moral choices. We don't expect ordinary drivers to make ethical or moral choices from a legal standpoint. You cannot expect that. It's not going to work. And that's why there's a lot of cases where the general public thinks somebody got away with murder, behind the wheel of a car or something, when in fact they've been acquitted because they did not actually break any rules. And that's a key point. Now, people are really hung up on these self-driving cars making these ethical choices. But, it just seems to me as it's more of a means of saying, hey, see, it's a bad idea. It can't make the ethical choice. Where what we should be considering is not whether the self-driving car is going to make a perfect choice in every situation, because it can't know what's an ethical choice. It can't. It doesn't have a model of the universe. It doesn't have a consciousness, right? It can't know what's an ethical choice or not. And holding the manufacturers of the machine responsible for making an ethical choice in unusual situations is not reasonable. And expecting them to have anticipated every possible situation is not reasonable. What we need to do for self-driving cars is not demand absolute perfection and moral behavior and ethical behavior. That's just ridiculous. We can't even get that out of human drivers. What we should be expecting is that these self-driving cars are no worse than human drivers. If they are at least as good as human drivers, they should be allowed on the road. If they are at least as good as human drivers, then they're no additional risk to the drivers on the road. So, anything that makes the self-driving car better than the human drivers on the road for objective metrics like accidents caused, accidents avoided, that sort of thing, behavior in general, anything that makes the self-driving cars better than human drivers should just be an additional push on the balance to get them on the road. Still, we do need to test them carefully, and they do need to be tested in crazy situations. And we should be testing human drivers in crazy situations as well. But they do need to be tested in these exceptional circumstances. They need to be tested to make sure that they at least behave deterministically and that they don't do something completely stupid. So slamming on the brakes to avoid hitting something that there's no path to swerve around is reasonable behavior, because that's about all you can do in that circumstance. Never mind what you're going to hit. It doesn't matter. If there's no path to swerve and avoid it, try to stop. That's your options. At the very least, you'll shed some speed and you'll reduce the severity of the impact. That is the absolute worst case. If you fail to stop, you will have at least slowed down. And every bit of speed you take off makes a substantial improvement in the potential outcomes. So slamming on the brakes and trying to stop is acceptable. Swerving to avoid if you have somewhere to go is acceptable. Trying to make a judgment call about which is a better choice when you have whether you should drive into a wall or hit a bus is not acceptable. Requiring that choice is not acceptable. It delays action by that much longer. And if the choice is to slam on the brakes, now you're going that much faster at impact. So the emphasis should be on a fast choice that minimizes risk to the occupant of the vehicle, because seriously, the occupant of the vehicle is the one who owns the vehicle. It's not reasonable for their vehicle to take action that deliberately harms them. It's not reasonable. And it needs to prioritize not hitting things, right? Seriously. So if you can avoid the situations, and a self-driving car should eventually be a lot better at avoiding these situations than a human, because it doesn't get bored, it doesn't zone out, it doesn't not see something because it happens to be looking somewhere else. All manner of things that cause humans to get in these situations where they don't have time to react. Self-driving car isn't going to do. So let's just throw this whole nonsense about having a self-driving car being able to make an ethical or moral choice. Throw that out. It's not going to happen. It's not reasonable. It's just a means of keeping them off the road. And all of you people out there making videos and writing articles that insist on bringing this up as something that a self-driving car has to do, think about it. Think carefully about it. You're part of the problem. You're expecting something that's not possible. And even if it is possible, it's not clear that it's desirable. Because it means somebody has to choose what is always the better choice. And it's not that clear from a human perspective. We cannot expect a machine to make human quality judgments. We can't expect that. It's never going to happen. We don't even know how or why we make those judgments, so how can we teach a machine to do it? And leaving that aside, whose morality do you choose? It varies. So anyway, throw that out. Forget about it. It has nothing to do with the problem at hand. Put the resources into avoiding the situations, not dealing with them, and put simple mechanisms for dealing with them. The same mechanisms that humans should be taught in driver training. Swerve and avoid if you can. Slam on the brakes if you can't. Or use proper threshold braking if you don't have anti-lock brakes. But that's what it comes down to. Give the self-driving car simple instructions to follow in the situation where it gets in a mess it can't deal with, and teach it to avoid messes. And guess what? We'll have much safer roads. Basically, forget the ethics. Self-driving cars don't need them. Forget the morality. Self-driving cars don't need it. Forget the bad decision situation calculus. You don't need it. The more complicated you make everything, the more likely it's going to go wrong. Instead, concentrate on making it the best possible driver within the rules of the road, and make it as good as you possibly can at avoiding bad situations. And that's not difficult. Like, at being able to detect situations well in advance. Solve that problem, and you will have a driver that is far better than human drivers, and the number of accidents will be reduced dramatically once that type of system gets going. Anyway, that's enough rambling on this for now. This has gone longer than I really intended for it to. But that's the thing. We need to stop getting hung up on these moral and ethical choices that, especially artificially constructed ones, that somehow we think that a self-driving car has to make because somehow we think humans make them while driving. We don't. When you really get down to it, the vast majority of us will just hit that bus. It's just the way of it. Anyway, that's all for this time. If you want to be notified of future videos, make sure to subscribe and enable notifications with that bell icon. And if you liked or didn't like the video, leave a like or a dislike. Apparently it helps with exposure. And if you've watched this far, thanks for watching.